so welcome everyone. So that's the last session today. So I just try to speed up a bit, but I don't think I come below like 20 minutes or so. Okay, so I'm speaking a bit about the Linux WPAN subsystem in the Linux kernel, together with SixLowPAN, which is also a subsystem in the Linux kernel. I'll talk a bit about the technologies behind that and about what kind of stuff is going on inside the project, how you can add it to your own hardware. Basically the agenda for today, just start up with a little bit of motivation here. I mean, it's really good in the evening, you need a bit of a start to get really motivated to listen to me here. Then I talk a bit of the project. As I said, the hardware, configuration, communication, and the edge node operating systems, there are various of these, but you know. Okay, so 15.4, what is it? It's an IEEE specification. For low-rate wireless. It was named low-rate wireless personal area networks before. They changed that because after something like 8 years or so, they realized that the personal area part is not really taking off. It's not only low-rate, but also low-power. So that means it's really designed to have like small sensors, something like that, running on a coin cell battery for months, maybe years, depending on the duty cycle you're going with that. That obviously has some drawbacks and some limitations. So one of the limitations you have here is the short maximum transfer unit you have on these kind of networks. You also have a bit of a limitation on the bandwidth, but bandwidth is not really that problematic if you just want to transfer some sensor data or something like that. So that's still okay. One thing that I always mention in this kind of talk is that there's always a bit of confusion with Zigbee here. So 15.4 is used by Zigbee or was used by the old native Zigbee stack, but 15.4 only specifies the PHY and the MAC layer, so you can use other things on top of that. For example, you could use 6LowPAN on top of that. So 6LowPAN, based on these IEEE specifications, the IETF sat down in 2007 and said, okay, we want to have more IP version 6 enablement, even in this kind of smaller networks, lossy networks and stuff like that. So they sat down and tried to design something that makes it possible to run IP version 6 packets or normal IP version 6 communication over this kind of limited networks. What basically came out of it is an adaptation layer that sits between the data link and the networking layer and handles all kinds of things like auto configuration, frame encapsulation, fragmentation, and reassembly, obviously. And one of the bigger things is header compression, which is one of the things that really made it possible to actually run these kind of huge IP version 6 packets in this kind of networks. So as I said, you can see here, it's just sitting in the, if you compare it to the OSI model or the normal stuff you would have on your workstation or something like that, it's just sitting between the MAC and the network layer here. There are various RFCs about that by now. It started in the 4000er series, and by now it's, I think they updated it in 2000, I don't know the exact date here, but it's still ongoing progress there, so that's good. So what kind of problems we have in these networks? As I said, the MTU is just 127 bytes, which is really small, which kind of creates a problem if you have big headers into the networking protocols over there. So let's go with the worst case scenario calculation here. That would mean that you have 127 bytes, you go ahead, you add the biggest possible frame header in this kind of networks, that would be already be 25 bytes. Then you would add link layer security, so you can, on 15.4, you can actually encrypt the frames with AES directly on the link layer, so that's quite good, we want that. But it obviously costs us size in terms of header. And if you would now go with a normal IP version 6 header, which is 40 bytes alone, and you add something like UDP on top, which is another 8 bytes, you're down to just 33 bytes in one frame you can submit here. And even if you look at the ratio here, that's really terrible. I mean, you have 3 parts headers, 1 part payload you can transfer in one frame. So that's really something, I mean, if you only want to transfer a few bytes, like windows open, windows closed, or the temperature or something like that, it might still be okay, but still the ratio is bad and we really can do better here. So what the ITF came up with was various things of compressing the header. For example, they're reusing the layer 2 address because that is part of the IP version 6 automatic auto-configured address already. And then some of the parts of the header, they just said, okay, that will always be null, or this will be some default values we rely on. For example, there is a version field in the IP version 6 header, which says this is version 6, but we know it will be version 6 because that's the only protocol we support here, so we can elite it completely. So if you go here and have link local communication with UDP on top, and we use the different kinds of compression techniques, I have some slides on that on the end. I don't know if you come to that, but if you have really technical questions about that, just come to me after the talk. And what you can do to make these 48 bytes I referred before with the IP version 6 header and UDP together, you can compress it down to like 6 bytes. That saves us a lot of time and the ratio gets a lot better as well. You can see here that it's just two parts headers and 3 parts of the payload actually. And here below, you can see what it actually is. You can, it's just a dispatch byte, and then you have another header for the IP header compression, and so on. And UDP is also getting compressed. The checksum here from UDP, you could also elite if you want, but then you have to make sure that on the application level layer side, you are sure that every packet is fine. So you need to make sure that on the other side. So normally, you don't want to delete that. So why we started this Linux WPAN project? Normally, you would expect that these kind of wireless transceivers are just on microcontrollers, and that's where they are mostly used. But on the other hand, you obviously need something that is actually connecting this kind of nodes to the network, to the real internet. That is where Linux comes into play, because that is where most of the operating systems that are running on gateways are based on Linux in some way or another. I mean, you could have like a smaller operating system, real-time operating system there as well, but normally, if you look at all the plastic boxes in your house that route you to the internet, that's Linux. So that really means that Linux itself would benefit from subsystems that are actually driving this kind of hardware and this kind of in 6LoWPAN in terms of header compressions and stuff like that. So 15.4 transceivers can easily be added to your normal hardware design. I come to that later, but it's really not much effort to do that. On the other hand, if you do that on the, if you want to do some sensors and stuff like that, you really want to take care about battery life, and you're not able to do that with Linux compared to what you can do with an RTOS like Zephyr or Contiki or Riot or something like that. So that really means that normally all the nodes you have around here are really running on something else. That is fine. I just care really about the gateway side at the moment. I mean, there are people that are interested in maybe getting Linux tiny enough to actually run it on the sensors as well, but that's a complete different topic, so that's not targeting here. And there's actually some hardware already out there that's supporting that. The most famous ones are the Nest thermostat and Protect and stuff like that. So all the Nest products have 15.4 transceiver inside their hardware to communicate to each other to build a mesh network. And that's called a thread network. And that's actually using 15.4 and 6LoWPAN and other stuff on top of it. Google also has this OneHub access point. I think they're now rebranded to Google Wi-Fi or something like that. They also have 15.4 hardware inside the case, but it's not enabled at the moment. And then there's, for example, from Imagination Technologies, it's a CI4 creator board, which also has 15.4 hardware directly on it. So the project was started in 2012 by some research group inside Siemens. At the point, they named it Linux Zigbee, which was a bit confusing, so we later renamed it and when we started to merge it mainline and so on. So it's a bit more less confusing now. Besides that, it's just a normal kernel development model, main list, patches posted, reviewed, getting into the tree and so on. So that's really nothing special or so. It's a kind of small community in terms of developers. There are just 2 core developers. We have like 4 or 5 more people that are actually caring mostly about drivers or some specific things. But I mean, there are around 100 people on the main list that are actually listening in. So there's some interest, but not really that much development effort from other people. So the current status we have a softmax driver layer. So that means the hardware can be really dumped and we augment all the other things inside the kernel softmax to make sure that it's working. We have 6 open support, full with fragmentation and reassembly, so that's the basic stuff you need in the beginning. And we also have support for all kind of header compression things, like the main things like IP header compression and next header compression with UDP. So that are the main things that actually save you bits on the airspace. The 6LoWPAN part for header compression is actually shared with the Bluetooth subsystem, because you can also run 6LoWPAN over Bluetooth. I mean, it was just started with 15.4, but by now there are different linked layers that actually can use 6LoWPAN. There are wired ones, there are more wireless ones, like I think DECT is coming up, then there are some power line communication things coming up, and. So a lot of protocols actually leveraging on this kind of ideas and technology to make sure that they can run IPv6 over their hardware. Yeah, we have active testing between Linux and Riot and Contiki. Yeah, and as I said, so it's a mainline project. So if you want to try it out, try something new, it's always better. So some development boards we are using right now. So obviously Raspberry Pi. You can see the small shield or head or whatever you want to call it here. That's an Atmel transceiver. That's just an open hardware project. I think you can buy it for like $10 or something like that. Then that's the CI40 creator board from MRNA Technologies. So that actually has a direct 6LoWPAN transceiver or 15.4 transceiver on it, which is also quite handy. If you want to do some development on your laptop or in your workstation or something like that, a USB dongle, that might be handy to actually get started, or you want to sniff network and see what's going on, that also helps. I tried to look around 96 boards. I haven't found anything about support for 15.4. I haven't seen anything on the light boards for 96 boards either. That's a bit pity. So if anybody or any hardware vendors is going to bring something up there, I would be interesting to hear about that. Because as I said, the hardware requirements are that easy. I mean, you only need a free SPI port and some GPIO pins, that's all. I mean, the number of GPIO pins really depends on the transceiver you're using. I think it goes down to like 3 or 4, or maybe goes up to 6 or 7, but really not that much that you need to add there. There are off-the-shelf modules that can you just hook up yourself, so that's what I do for development. I have like 4 or 5 different transceivers as modules, and then just hook them up to the SPI port and a Raspberry Pi and be done with it. So that's easy enough. Or you can use USB, but that's nothing you really want to be in production with. Yeah, so, oh, that's really tiny, sorry about that. So, yeah, basically just a device tree binding. So, easy enough to do. You have just a compatible statement you do here is you have an SPI maximum frequency. You say on what SPI port it's running, what is the interrupt line actually you're using, and then some extra stuff depending on the transceiver. So, all of the drivers you have in tree are device tree enabled, so that's easy enough to play around with. We have drivers for various Atmel transceivers that are out there. We have support for a microchip transceiver, one from TI, the ATUSB, that's a USB dongle that's based on an Atmel chip, plus some MCU with the firmware running on it. And there's also support for some analog devices transceiver. And there's 2 drivers, one is pending right now, that's in the final stages of the review, and another one for NXP that's actually in the work right now. So. Looking quite good in terms of coverage of transceivers that are out there. There's also these XP models that actually communicate over a serial line and have kind of a high abstraction layer. So there is an out-of-tree driver for that, but we have really a bit of trouble to integrating that into the kernel level. You will see if that's going to turn out at some point. Yeah, that is also just a quick overview. You don't have to guess all of that. Can really see that's a lot of that's the transceivers I actually looked around that I was able to find. Most of them have a driver for us. Yeah, and then you can see that some are in the 2.4 gigahertz band, some in the sub gigahertz band. That is actually a bit troublesome for me to test because it's not easy to do in Europe. You have to find the right transceivers and everything. And yeah. So if you just want to get started or something, you can just start with a virtual driver here. That's really similar to hardware from the wireless group, which is really easy to get going, get testing just on your laptop without any hardware connected to that. We have support inside Riot and OpenThread. I don't know if it's merged by now, the pull request, or if it's still sending outside. but we support both of them, that they can run on top of these virtual interfaces we are offering. So that means you can have, you just load the fake loopback module here, say you want 4 different nodes available, and then you can just go ahead and configure one as a Linux system. Then you can configure one to run Riot on top of it as a Linux native process, or OpenThread as a Linux native process, and a 4th one, for example, as Monitor, and then you can really see what's going on, how they can communicate and stuff like that. So that really helps in interop testing, and if you want to just don't have all the hardware with you all the time. Configuration itself is also quite easy. We based our IWPAN tool on IW from, again, from the wireless community. It's used to configure the FI and the MAC layers, basic things like channel, PAN ID, power settings, frame retries, and so on and so on. So this is actually packaged by some distributions by now. Some others are lagging behind, but it's also quite easy to compile, so it's not nothing really stopping you. Another thing we came up with is that for really early on testing, if you want to see just if the driver works and stuff like that, a tool like Ping would be really handy, but we really wanted to be on the 15.4 layer and not already on 6.0.open because there can be a lot of other things that can go wrong in between. So what we did is like we came up with a WPAN Ping replacement more or less. We have to have run a daemon on one side because it's not really the ICMP protocol, and then you can go ahead and just send packets and test out short and extended addresses and so on. Measures performance, for example, you can do that as well. The bring up itself is also quite easy. So once either the device tree is detected correctly or the USB dongle got injected and detected, the WPAN 0 interface comes up. You have to bring it down again if you want to set some specific parameters and not the default one. So if you want to set the PAN ID or the channel, you have to make sure that you set down the interface first. Then you can set all the parameters you want to do here. And then you have to add the low-pan 0 interface that you have to do on your own if you want to run 6.0.open on top of that. And yeah, just bring the devices up again. And after that, you have two devices, WPAN 0 and low-pan 0. And on low-pan 0, you can actually go ahead and use normal IP version 6 communication. And if you want to go do it on the 15.4 level, you can still do that. That is on WPAN 0. Can do all of stuff. If you want to go ahead and just monitor what's going on in one of these networks, just to debug it or just to develop new things, you could do that as well. You would delete the normal interface that comes up because that's not in monitor mode. Then you bring it up again and say that's a type monitor. So you just add a new interface that is actually in monitor mode, and that makes sure that the driver sets the device into promiscuous mode and all the other things you might have to do. Disables all the hardware address translations and detections and so on. There's no automatic channel hopping or something like that. So if you want to go through all the channels and make sure that you're finding all the networks available, you have to do that in the background. You can do that while the device is up, that's not a problem, but you still have to do that manually. So yeah, as I said, communication. So the whole idea is that you don't have to care about that in user space. You don't have to care about in your application that you're running on these kind of networks. You just use standard IP version 6. Just a normal socket interface, and that is what actually the project is offering. So all the stuff we are doing is just hooking beneath the normal IP version 6 network stack in the Linux kernel. So everything you do with the interface should work, and it's just transparently handled within our stack. So just basically, as I said, set up a socket, set the address family to INET6, and then just go ahead, send to, receive from, and so on. So just the normal stuff you would do. It's a bit different if you want to do it for 15.4. Basically, it's only because there could be different addresses. So 15.4 has two types of addresses. It could be a 2-byte one and an 8-byte one address. The extended one is the one that's actually coming from the unique permanent hardware address from the device. And the short one is actually normally set within a network to save, again, header space, if you're sending messages around the normal coordinator, kind of DHCP server in these kind of networks, handing out addresses and saying, okay, I give you address number 2, and the next time I have to communicate with you, I only have to send 2 bytes for the address and not 8. So that's saving you stuff again. And to make sure that actually that is working, we have to handle that somehow. And so that makes it a little bit different here. So you can just see that the address type, you set it to long or to short, and then you can just set the address here. And you also have to set the PAN ID if you don't want to use the default one, which means all the PAN IDs around. And after that, you have just the normal send to commands. So that's a normal Socket Berkeley interface, so you're really used to that. So coming to the other side of the network, the edge node operating systems. As I said, the use case I see is Linux mostly running on the border router here, or gateway, you want to call it. On the nodes, it's really most likely that you have different operating systems here at the moment. So I picked some that are actually supporting 15.4 right now and 6.0.pn right now, and try to find out what is actually good, what I can test against, and what is not working well. So the oldest one actually is Contiki here. It's a very fragmented project. There's a lot of academic research on that, there still is. And there's a lot of commercial forks of it, and it has been a really hard time sometimes to merge the things back into the main project. It got better again with Contiki 3.0, but it's still stalling again, so I don't know how sustainable this is over time. So it's still used a lot, yeah, so you have to support it somehow, but it's not really growing in the direction I like it to see. So then you have Riot, which is really driven by community. They have testing against Linux in their normal release process, for example. We have a lot of good communications with them. What they are missing is kind of the commercial side. So, I mean, there are some smaller companies using it in their products, but it's not like some big companies are behind that and pushing it forward. So it's good on the community side, but it's a little bad on resources that actually they have available. Yeah, so therefore, that's the most prominent one here. There's a new networking stack that's merged by now, and that actually has good support for 15.4. I haven't tested it yet. I have a Carbon BLE board with me and a transceiver that I want to hook up to it. So that's something I want to do this week. So testing against our implementation to see what's working, what's not working. So I don't have results for that right now, but that's something I want to have at the end of the week. I also looked into EmbedOS. The problem I had there is that the networking stack is closed source. So everything else, open source, nice, code available. And then I looked at the parts that interest me, and there have been only object files around. And they said, yeah, no, the nano stack, that's closed source. You only get it if you're a member or whatever, you pay for it. I don't know what the details are about that. So that's really incentive for me to test further. So and then there's OpenThread, which is driven by Nest Labs. So they implement the thread protocol, which the thread group defines, which is based on 15.4 and 6.0.pn. So they have an open source implementation for that. And as I mentioned before, we can run that as a native Linux application and just use our virtual environment, and then we can test against that. So that's quite nice, actually. Yeah, just a quick comparison here. So the normal data and ACK frames, that's something all of them support. I mean, I only have these three here because I have trouble with the other ones. Most of them don't support beacon and MAC command frames. That's basically right now the case because you don't need it. If you just want to use 6.0.pn communication, you don't need that in any way. But the point where you need it is if you really want to bring out a network, bring it to production, everything, because you need it for bootstrapping, finding networks, making sure that everything is working, getting the device onboarded and stuff like that. So that's something that is missing, and we plan to work on that on the Linux side, and I know that the others are planning on that as well. So linked layer security, yeah, that's something we have and Contiki have, so we tested against that. It's a bit tricky because all the key handling, rollover and stuff like that, that is not really defined. The only thing 15.4 defines are the basic primitives, how to get encryption, everything working on that. So that's a bit of a sore spot there. Yeah, and then all the basic other things are supported everywhere, like the normal compression and encapsulation, stuff like that. Yeah, I think that's basically covered it. So what do we have in the future? what we need to do is implement MAC and command frames. We need to make sure that we actually have a coordinator that can hand out short addresses and stuff like that. Make sure that we have support for all of that in the user space tooling. Make sure that we can scan for networks, join them, and all the basic things to get that working. We have a bit of a trouble with all kind of hard MAC transceivers out there because our stack has some unoptimal handling of these, so some of the stuff have to be handled in the driver, which should not be the case. That's something we have to work out what the problems are there and get that fixed in the stack, but that's also work in progress, and that really only comes up if new drivers are getting submitted and we actually see what kind of problems are there. Yeah, the OpenThread on top of the virtual interface, that works well. And we want to see if we can actually make sure that OpenThread also runs on our Mac stack and not only on the virtual interface. So that is actually something that we are also in progress here. And we need to make sure that we are exposing all the relevant informations for our kind of routing and mesh protocols that are coming up. So there are things like Ripple, and Thread also has a mixture of mesh under protocol routing plus some routing on top. Root over protocols, so we need to make sure that all the information that is available on the transceivers, on the stack itself, to expose that. But that's something really we only want to do, expose that, once we have some actual users in user space that are making sure that it's working well and we are not just exposing APIs we have to support for the next, whatever, 30 years and nobody's using that. So, yeah. But what I do is next month there is NetDev and there's it's workshop as a conference from all the Linux networking people, and I'm actually holding a workshop there to see what kind of information user space would need, routing protocols would need, to gather that all together to maybe get an idea what we need to expose there. Okay, so what's the takeaway for today? So running this kind of networks is really easy to do. All the tooling is already there under Linux. Adding it to your hardware is also easy enough to do. Yeah, and the border router, that's actually the scenario I think most about right now, but there could be more. So if anybody's interested in running that on the sensors itself, making Linux tiny enough, that's also interesting to hear about, but that's nothing I tackle or something like that. So that would be from my side, so thank you for coming here, and I'm open for questions now.